Hello there, and welcome to another episode of Talking Tunes with Turnip. It's the 4th of July today in the old U.S. of A. And everywhere else, I suppose, but you know what? Forget everywhere else. That's what we do on the 4th of July. We forget everywhere else, and we focus on God's favorite country, old Estados Unidos. Today is the day where we all unitos around the grill. Maybe have a couple of hot dog hamburgers, you know, and maybe a couple of more after that, you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying. Hey, you know why they call it the 4th of July? Because it's that one day a year when everyone says, oh, July, sure wish I hadn't had that 4th hot dog hamburgers. July, sure wish I hadn't had that 4th hot dog hamburgers. Everyone says that, and everyone turns to the person and says that and says, why did you just call me Jewel? It seemed like you just said July just then. And then everyone responds, Jewel, don't you ever fucking call me out on July 4th. Because I have the freedom of speech. And the next time you call me out, while all of us are junitos around my grill, I'm gonna knock every hot dog hamburger off this grill and grill you on this grill. That's a nice grill. I will acknowledge that this July 4, 2024, there stands an elephant in the room. And a donkey, for that matter, you know? There was a debate in these United States. People are angry about it. Some people are calling it a disaster. Others still are calling it a disaster without precedent, but I don't know that it was. I want to impart a message of calm here because I know that it was a disaster, but you know, will it be disastrous for either party? I don't think so. I feel like the stakes were pretty low. This was really a cursory test of whether or not the two presidential candidates could say two sentences in a row, and almost all of them could. I don't know why people are so upset. Of course, it's upsetting that this is the state of these United States, but, I mean, look, the Republicans are completely at peace with the chaotic nature of their candidate, and the Democrats have made it very clear that they are willing to perform blood magic and pharmaceutical torture to bring Joe Biden back to life every night from now until November 5th, if need be. Now we know that it need be. I find a certain calm in knowing. And this is not me trying to be a jerk. What was concerning to me was that little period right before the debate where people were telling us we didn't know anything about what we knew. You know, remember that? The recent past where people were telling us, who said that? Joe Scarborough said that, you know, this was the best version of Joe Biden. A political pundit said that. The best version, like he's a Samsung Galaxy. Bill McGibbon said that Biden's age was actually his superpower. Hey, I'd rather fly. He said that in the LA Times. Seth MacFarlane quote tweeted it. He said, this is something that's been rattling around in my brain for some time. And Bill McGibbon finally articulated it here better than I ever could. Age matters, which is why Biden's age is his superpower. And a tweet underneath it with 1,400 likes says this post should be a Family Guy cutaway joke. I prefer Bill Maher's take on this matter because I do think it's the honest one. He said, I would vote for Joe Biden's head in a jar before Donald Trump. Hey, I got great news. You're ordering right off the menu. Special of the day is jar head. Someone called Jake Gyllenhaal. I say, why stop at one jar? Get them both jarred up so we can see these two leathery heads go head to head every few years like LeBron and Steph Curry. Or better yet, you get one big jar and stick them both in it. Then they can spend all day performing the presidency as like a double act where there's hijinks.
Joe, did you call the pizza place?
I sure did. Tell them what you want, Joe.
Joe, you're Joe. Who do you got on the phone? Joe, this is Vladimir Zelensky, you idiot. Now he's gonna ask for our pizza money.
My son's not an idiot. You're the idiot. My age is my superpower. I traveled here from the past.
You know what we should talk about? The past of our superpower. Let's not fret over our uncertain national future. While this debate was perhaps mind-blowing, I doubt it was mind-changing for either side of the aisle. It certainly didn't change the polls. For the most part, people vote tribally, and I know that we know that. And I feel like I know that more than ever in the aftermath of this debate. So the minds aren't changing. This song, by the way, is The Times Are A-Changing by one of my favorite bands, Medeski, Martin, and Wood. The song, of course, is Bob Dylan's. It's a beautiful song. The times they are changing, and it speaks to the optimism of the baby boomer generation. It speaks of the triumph of the underclass, karmic reversals. The first one now will later be last. For the times they are changing. Our two presidential candidates were 22 and 18 when it was released. Biden came from a wealthy family, sailing yachts off the coast of New England, driving fast cars, flying airplanes. Trump was the heir to his father's real estate empire. They were both pretty close to first. And now, 60 years later, are literally vying for the foremost seat of power in the world. But in Bobby's defense, he never said how much later they'd be last. And the times did change. A lot was accomplished in the late 60s, early 70s. The times they are changing came out 3 years before interracial marriage was legal. A year before the Voting Rights Act of 65, Hawaii and Alaska were barely states. Things changed, you know? I think that's why the future for America is going to be looking towards its great past. We're going to be one of those nations, like England, you know? It's like if you watch a movie about England, you know, they're not talking about the Tony Blair administration. They're talking like this. And everyone is talking about who the Dowager Countess is having over for tea. England is about who England used to be. When you make a movie about Germany, it's about the Holocaust. They're playing the hits, baby. America, in hindsight, we're the 1970s, man. We're a decade of dreamers. We're a David Lynch movie without the scary parts. Please, no scary parts. We have enough to be scared of lately. Timothy Chalamet's the biggest movie star in the world right now. His last three roles were Bob Dylan, Gene Wilder, Kyle MacLachlan. We're the past. You're only going to see 2024 in a movie if it's in an appendix to a movie about the 1960s. It's like, you know, you'll see Timothy Chalamet as Bob Dylan walk past Donald Trump at age 18. And his dad will have his arm around his shoulder and he'll be like, "And that, son, is how you evict black people from a building." Or you'll see a movie about Zendaya trying to take a bus to school, and Joe Biden will stand over her shoulder and say, "No, no, no." And then that will cut to a little infographic that says he is currently running for president. You know, like a "Where Are They Now?" But more importantly, where are we now? Now that America's in its greatest hits era, what were our greatest hits? We had some hits. I think it's important to remember that. We had some hits. The rule of law, for one. Government based upon an agreed-upon system of ideas, rather than by the blood right of the inbred children of kings. No offense, England. Then a bit later, Coca-Cola. And the invention of the light bulb. Courtesy of Thomas Alva Edison of West Orange, New Jersey. Hey, you see that thing in front of you? Well, you're welcome. And those are our greatest hits in order. Today we remember them. And we remember Bob Dylan. And we remember a time when we as a nation knew that our youth was our superpower. Our naivety was our wisdom. And the world could be remade in the image of our dreams. But more importantly, Drake and Kendrick Lamar are beefing. Speaking of our nation, America just won a highly publicized battle over Toronto, Canada. Kendrick Lamar of Compton, California has bested Toronto rapper Drake. That's what everyone is saying. Everyone is saying it. Everyone but one person. I'm so sorry to do this. And I'm especially sorry to be denigrating a decisive American victory on this most holiest of days. In defense of Canada, no less. That's like if your wife was in a fist fight and you tell her, "Oh, you know, honey, you know who actually made some good points back there was your twin sister."
I can hardly believe it. I can hardly believe I'm taking the side of Canada, but I will say this. Kendrick Lamar lives in Los Angeles, which is also not part of America. The average American probably has more in common with a person from Toronto than the average Californian. Because at least in Canada, they grow up watching our TV shows and listening to our music. Kids who grow up in LA don't want to take their work home. They're already on TV. They've been on TV since they were first prescribed Adderall at the age of 6 because their AD got mad that their on-set tutor was teaching them the alphabet when they were supposed to be running lines with January Jones, and now he's losing light. The average American child spends their formative years riddled with ennui, unsure of whether or not they'll make it out of their backwater town or take over their father's job managing the quick shop. The average child from Los Angeles is surfing and smoking hydroponic marijuana with the chemical potency of the blue meth from Breaking Bad, you know? I say all this to say I don't have a dog in the fight, and I mean that, because I'm a huge fan of Kendrick Lamar. I was a fan of his not all the way back. I'm not gonna sit here and pretend I was listening to the C4 mixtape in my lowrider. But I was a fan of Section 80 when it came out. Of course I'm a fan of Kendrick Lamar, so I'm a white person. And he rapped very quickly. This is Rigamortus and it's gorgeous when you die. You know, he was very fast when he was rapping, and it's very smart to be very fast. And when I told people I liked him, they told me I was very smart. When I was in high school, I put on the song Rigamortus for my high school girlfriend, and I told her this young man is the next Bob Dylan. That happened. Now, I'll tell you something else that happened. I first danced with that young girl at her bat mitzvah to the song You the Fucking Best. So you see, I'm caught in between worlds, a man without a country, so to speak. So when this feud between Drake and Kendrick Lamar emerged, I took it track by track with bated breath, like I was watching my own two children lob hand grenades at one another. I was like, oh, there you go, son, good catch. Oh, no, wait. And I will say this, one of them won. And one of them was funny. And being funny will always win over being smart. George Carlin can talk till he's blue in the face about how our government is a joke, and religion is a joke, and the middle of a country is a joke, and I can really appreciate that. But you know what I really appreciate? Jokes. I like a laugh now and again. Funny beats smart. I'm sorry. Jeff Dunham sold out Madison Square Garden 10 times with a fucking puppet. Most people think funny shit is funny. Right now, people are enjoying Clever Kendrick. Sure. Kendrick's gonna put out an album about how you should go to a therapist and brush your teeth, and Drake's gonna put out an album about how he brushed his teeth with the underwear of his therapist's mother. And people are gonna say, you know what? I kinda like that. But for now, people are telling us Kendrick Lamar won. Things got emotional. At first, he was almost complimentary. He said, I like when you sing. You know, you're a master manipulator. That's not bad. He's achieved mastery. And that's also a weird insult, isn't it? To level against a pop star. It's like looking at the Trix Rabbit and being like, that, you know, you're a master manipulator. You would say anything to get those kids eating cereal. That's his job, you know? It's not terribly complicated what he does. Children like sugar. He sells bowls of sugar. Kids like ostentatious and scandalous behavior. His entire life is ostentatious scandals. Conversely, what I might describe as manipulative behavior would be posting photos taken from within someone's home and using them as your album art. That's a bit fruity. He was posting his shirts, he was posting his, you know, old prescriptions. And what's the implication there? I had one of your boys go through your trash like it's Watergate, but it's a professional disagreement? I don't know. Things got inconsistent. I hate the way you walk, the way you talk. I hate the way you dress. It turns into, I don't have a hating bone in my body. That's an emotional pivot. But all the same, the people say Kendrick came with facts and Drake came with the jokes. What were the facts? That Drake is a pedophile? He's not. Unless he is, I don't know. But no one seems to know. And if Drake, international pop star, was a pedophile, I think we'd know by now. You know, people are comparing him to Michael Jackson. Prince outlived Mike Jack. People are comparing him to Michael Jackson. Do you know how many kids accused Michael Jackson in the 90s? Every one of them. Everyone. I accused him one night in my bedroom. I said, Mama, I felt a cold breeze. She said, nope, that was him. Call TMZ, we're gonna be rich. But Kendrick Lamar says, Drake is like Michael Jackson. He's not like us. And maybe he is. He lives in Hollywood.
I don't know what he does. We don't visit. But I have to imagine that by now, we would have seen a teary 10-year-old talking to Ellen DeGeneres or someone, right? I mean, all we've seen is that one picture of him with Millie Bobby Brown, and I'm sorry. It's not that compelling to me. I guess it's kind of weird. But when I talk to people about it, they're like, you know, he groomed her. He asked her father for paternity. He was raising her as a child bride. They took a picture together. She, a child actor, took a picture with Drake, a former child actor, who I'm sure a lot of people want pictures with. But people are like, no, this was different. This girl was different. Just look at her. She's so damn beautiful. So goddamn irresistible. They start licking their chops. It's strange. Sure, she's a lovely girl. And like every lovely little girl, she looks like a lovely little boy. She had a buzz cut at the time and everything. You know, when I was her age, I looked just like her. And then people will try to qualify it and say, no. He saw her as a sex object, the way men saw Natalie Portman in 1994. Then they just start to list all the little girls in history they found attractive. Jennifer Connelly in Labyrinth. Hermione Granger in the third one, maybe even the second one. I don't know, man. It was just a picture. And you know what else? Stranger Things was a hit. Maybe he fucking liked that show. He's on a tour bus for half his life. He'd probably seen everything on Netflix. If I was at a party in LA and one of the little kids from Game of Thrones walked in, I'd be jumping with my fucking arm around him like this. I'd be like, take a picture of me holding him like I'm the giant. I'd give him my phone number. I'd be texting him all the time. What are dwarves like? Hey, text me if you need literally anything. Because Hollywood is a scary place, and if anyone tries to hurt you, I will feed them to an actual wolf. And I know a lot of you are not sold. A lot of the ladies are not sold. They've maybe had an interaction with a Drake type in their youth. They harbor the prejudice that comes with the burden of knowledge. Ladies, entertain a scenario for me, please. The year is 2002. You are your current age. You're at a party in West London. People are chattering on about fish and chips and beans on toast. And through the chatter, you hear an adorable voice say, "Is that a spoiler? Anything but spoilers." And across the crowded room, you spot a crown of pumpkin red hair. Ron Weasley is there, standing in full cape. He waves his wand and says, "Camricus," and a Polaroid appears right in your hands. What do you do? What do you do? Finally, I want to end with my first ever favorite song, American Pie, Don Maclean. This, to my knowledge, was my first favorite song as a little boy. It is about a mass death, and I think it's actually a perfect song for children. It starts off a little melancholy, and children are a little melancholy, aren't they? It's because of the ennui, like we said earlier, and it's also because they suck. They can't do anything. They don't have any money. They can't get laid. They're basically not people to be taken seriously. Then the song moves gently into a state of energy. The tempo picks up, and he starts literally launching into children's rhymes. "Drove my Chevy to the levee, but I could not, would not on a boat. I will not with a goat. What are we doing here? I drove my Honda to the pond, and I ate a large fry." If we're just having fun with words, but there's a tempo shift. Things are getting happy. He's talking about pie. This is a dream come true for children. Then shit really changes, and now we're rocking out. And kids are losing their minds at this point, because kids love when shit changes. You know, American Pie was sort of the sicko mode of its time, where it's literally just two songs stapled on top of each other. I think if you were to ask Travis Scott who his biggest influences were, he'd say, number one, Don McLean. Number two, Kanye West. And then Satan. I like Sicko Mode. It's just too much. It's literally too much for a human to process at one time. It's like the sonic equivalent of having a Crunchwrap Supreme. It just sizzles your serotonin receptors. I think Sicko Mode actually could have been embraced as a children's song the way that Old Town Road was if Drake just could go 30 seconds without talking about popping pills. But American Pie is a great children's song, because it suddenly gets very exciting indeed. Did you write the Book of Love? Nope, I'm a little kid. Do you have faith in God above? Chill out, man. The kids love it. He starts singing about jesters and kings and queens and James Dean, and they don't know who that is, but that's the great thing about rhymes, just pleasurable sounds. The kids don't need to know that the big bopper is dead. It's just good noise. But then, over time, kids do find out about things, you know, like the big bopper. I remember finding out who all these different little characters were in the songs, and it was so exciting. The marching band takes the field. You find out later, oh, the marching band is the Beatles. I know them well. They have songs about octopuses and submarines. It's like the childhood prelude to reading On the Road and being like, oh, holy shit, Neil Cassidy is Dean Moriarty. Oh, shit. Don McLean has called Mick Jagger the devil like 5 times. It starts off playful. He's called him, you know, Jack Flash, Jack Be Nimble, Jack Be Quick. He's doing nursery rhymes again. Jack Flash sat on a candlestick. Okay, he's got a stick up his ass. Don has sodomized him, because fire is the devil's only friend. Whoa. And as I watched him on the stage, my hands were clenched in fists of rage. No angel born in hell could break that Satan spell? Hey man, sacrilege. I wish I felt that passionately about a celebrity I hate. I wonder if I do. I don't care for the comedy of Pete Davidson, but I can't say he's ever made me clench my hands in fists of rage. This song ties into another song that I love, at least I thought I did. It's pretty well known that Don McLean, artist of American Pie, was the inspiration for the song Killing Me Softly by Lori Leiberman, which is a beautiful, beautiful song. I always just assumed that the song Don McLean was killing this young lady softly with was American Pie, his song. But it wasn't. It wasn't even Vincent he killed her softly with. It was a song called Empty Chairs. Empty Chairs. That's like if you're a cartoonist and you fall in love with Walt Disney and they ask you, oh, what did it? It's like, well, I fell in love with Oswald the Lucky Rabbit. That's not his thing. That's like getting killed softly to a Thin Lizzy song and it's not The Boys Are Back in Town. It's like, do you even know who just got back today? I don't know. It speaks to her character. But Killing Me Softly is a beautiful song. I tend to think of the Roberta Flack version and the Lauryn Hill version. It's sort of one of those songs like House of the Rising Sun where someone else covers it and now yours just kind of sucks. You're Bob Dylan, but everyone thinks that you're covering the animals. Can you imagine writing a song and being like, oh my goodness, I've written a masterpiece, and then you hear the Roberta Flack version of it, and all of a sudden this beautiful song, and now you just sound like you're singing the weepy white woman version instead of the badass black lady version of the song. But then, of course, karma paid her back because Lauryn Hill recorded a version of the badass black lady version of the song, and now Roberta Hill's version is like, I don't know. You don't want to have the second most badass black lady version of a song. I'd rather die. You might as well have the weepy white lady version of the song. I don't really feel that way. I don't feel any way about anything I've said. I love Empty Chairs. I love weepy white love. I actually sing both of these songs in my karaoke sets. I do a fraught love affair themed karaoke set. It goes American Pie, Killing Me Softly, Cry Me a River, Justin Timberlake, Stan by Eminem. And that's only if I drank enough during American Pie to really honor Stan by Eminem, and I always do. Really, an evening of karaoke is just a pretense for me to get drunk enough to sing Stan by Eminem, and then both parts of Beyoncé's 2013 hit single Drunk and in Love. I like a theme set. I've been doing that for a while. It all started as an accident, actually. I was meeting an ex-lover at an old karaoke bar that had been the site of our courtship. She lived very far away, and I had to drive very long distance to get there. I thought we were going to have a sort of still crazy after all these years type evening. I thought we were gonna talk about old times and have ourselves some beers. Instead, she ghosted me, so I had myself a bad time, and I drank myself some beers. And I drank enough that I thought it would be clever to treat the bar to Stan, to Eminem Stan. I got up on stage, the Sade instrumental came in, and immediately the temperature of the room just dropped 29 degrees. I rapped heartily the words of Marshall Mathers, And I sang the song, too, like when he performed it at the Grammys with Elton John. Man, how come Elton John did that, right? I know the Grammys did that. Eminem had said all that horrible shit about gay people, and the Grammys wanted to give Eminem a Grammy, so they gave him a stage time with who was, at that time, the only gay man everyone had heard of. But why did Elton John do that? I mean, that's like if, after all the shit that Donald Trump went through, you know, with what he said about Mexican people, he went up to give his inaugural address and was like, "But first, ladies and gentlemen, Juno Diaz. But do your thing, Elton, you know?" Maybe he just said to himself, "You know what? I haven't been on TV since Princess Diana died. I gotta pay for these fancy suits." Or maybe he really loved those Eminem songs and believed they were totally fine. Maybe he was gay for Eminem. I don't know. But I was singing Stan at the karaoke bar where I got stood up. And as I was standing up on stage, I saw the door open. And I was really getting into it. "We waited in the blistering cold for 4 hours and you just said no." But I was singing Stan at the karaoke bar where I got stood up. I got ghosted. And it's crazy when you get ghosted, you know? Because your first thought is always like, okay, they're late. Your second thought is they have been Liam Neeson taken and I am the one who has to save them and I have a very unspecific set of skills. I can't do much. And then your final thought is they've ghosted me. I hope they are dead. So I'm thinking this. I'm performing Stan. And then I saw the door open and my former lover, she was just late, you know. And the thing about Stan is, it is so, so long. And I was in like minute 3 of the 7-minute Eminem song Stan in front of a woman who had recently left me. I had to play it off quick. I had to pitch it as a joke. I made an elaborate lie about doing karaoke theme sets. And then I sang American Pie and Killing Me Softly. And I was informed that Killing Me Softly was actually about the song Empty Chairs. So it was a good thing. I learned something. I hope we all learned something in this episode. You know, thank you so much if you listened to this. And more Turnip content is coming out in the months to come. I'm unsure of what and when right now. I have a project that I did for a minute hour collage piece. I think that should be coming out soon. I hope it is. I hope you have a very happy 4th of July. I am very happy with you. Goodbye! Please like and subscribe.